Okay, so let me give you just a few more examples, Michael, of how PCA and ICA differ. And I'm going to do this mainly by talking about certain things that ICA does. And this is really just for your edification, but I think it really helps to think about those sort of underlying models and how they differ by thinking about how they react differently to different kinds of data. So just here's a couple of examples. The one we covered right away was the blind source separation problem. And of course, what we recall is that ICA, in some sense, was designed to solve the blind source separation problem. And in fact, ICA does an excellent job at solving the blind source separation problem. Meanwhile, PCA does a terrible job at solving the blind source separation problem. And that's just because it's assuming these kind of Gaussian distribution. It just does not recover what's going on. But here's something that ICA does differently from PCA, is because it's got this kind of blind source root in it, it's actually directional. And what I mean by that is, you recall I drew this sort of matrix before, where we had features this way, and we had samples of those features, like sound, time samples of sound, this way. It turns out that for PCA, it doesn't matter whether I give you this matrix or I give you the transpose of this matrix, it ends up finding the same answer. And that should make sense, right? Because it's just basically finding a new rotation of the data, and these are effectively just rotations of each other for the purposes of if you just kind of think about it geometrically in space. ICA, on the other hand, gives you completely different answers if you give it this versus giving it this. So ICA is highly directional, and PCA much less so. But ICA, because it's making this kind of fundamental assumption, does end up generating some really cool results. So I'm going to give you another example of one that's like the blind source separation one. In fact, I'm going to give you two, okay? So imagine you had a bunch of inputs of faces, okay? So here's my input, faces. I give you bunches and bunches and bunches of faces. What do you think PCA would do? What do you think the first principal component of PCA would be over pictures of thousands and thousands and thousands of faces?
Overall darkness of the image.
Actually, that's exactly right. The first thing that PCA tends to do with images, we're talking pictures, not just sketches here, is it finds the direction of maximal variance, and that tends to be brightness or luminance, which kind of makes sense because that's typically the kind of thing that gets varied the most. So in fact, the first thing people often do when they're trying to use PCA on faces is they normalize all of that away because the first principal component isn't terribly helpful. It's just kind of giving you the average light. What do you think the second thing it would find would be?
Hair versus not hair?
No, interestingly enough, what it ends up finding is sort of the average face, which is kind of like the question you asked me earlier about what happens if you go through the origin. So there's actually names for this. It's called the eigenfaces because, you know, as I noted before, it's an eigenproblem, and it basically finds kind of the average face. And that's kind of weird, but it works for reconstruction. I don't know what the average face here would look like. Probably something like this. Yeah, so you can see how useful that would be. Not even clear that's a face. But it works for reconstruction. Do you know what ICA ends up finding?
Noses?
Yes, it finds noses. It finds eye selectors. It finds mouth selectors. It finds hair selectors. And I think intuitively, the way I would think about this is because PCA is doing this global orthogonality thing, it's going to be forced to find global features. ICA, I didn't say was global, and that's because it's basically local. It doesn't care about orthogonality. So it tends to find parts of. If you feed it the matrix the right way, it tends to find parts of. And so it ends up finding these little selectors. So this has a really nice outcome in cases like natural images or natural scenes. So what do you think happens, Michael, if I take natural scenes, you know, pictures of the forest and grass and walking around, just things that I would see if I were just walking out in the world and taking bunches of pictures, and I feed it into ICA? Well, the answer for PCA, by the way, is the same as before. You get brightness, you get sort of the average image, things that really make sense if your goal is to do reconstruction. But ICA actually gives you something different. What do you think the independent components, the underlying causes, so to speak, of natural scenes are?
I'm still thinking about the face parts, but by analogy, it seems like it would be you know, things in the world like trees and rocks and ground.
Not quite, and that's, I think, in part because there are too many of those things that kind of overlap in too many different ways. It actually finds something more fundamental.
Edges.
That's exactly right. ICA finds edges. Now, for me, that is incredibly satisfying. It says that the independent components of the world are edges. Now, there are two things that come out of this. One is just the satisfying feeling you get by realizing that there's an algorithm that on its own recovers something fundamental like edges. That's very nice. But the second thing that's nice about it is once I use ICA to do my feature transformation and discover that what it's learning are edge detectors, well, then I can just write edge detectors. I can just write algorithms that are very fast, very efficient, that can go through images of natural scenes and pull out the edges. It's unclear how to do that with, you know, different principal projections. But if edges are the fundamental building blocks of natural scenes, then there are people who know how to write edge detectors very quickly. By the way, you get a similar result. I won't talk about it, but you get a similar result in our information retrieval problem where you have documents. And you can read this in the material we give you. But what ICA ends up giving you for documents are topics. And they're very easily interpreted that way. Collections of words that select for specific topics that are themselves made up of collections of words that select for topics and collections of uncorrelated words that get rid of distractor documents. So the independent components of scenes are edges, and the independent components of documents are topics. And that feels very nice. But in both of these cases, both with edges and with topics, it turns out that the form of these topics are something that you can compute very, very quickly and sort of independently of the underlying ICA algorithm. So why does that matter, Michael? Well, remember what I said originally about unsupervised learning, what it was good for, was understanding your data, doing kind of data analysis from a human being's point of view. So what something like ICA and other algorithms we might imagine do is they allow you to do analysis over your data to discover fundamental features of them, like edges or topics or noses and eyes. And then once you understand that's what's making up your data, you can simply write code that will select for it or figure out what the important parts of your data are correspondingly. And so here we haven't just done this feature transformation problem for the sake of doing classification. Feature transformation actually helps us to understand the fundamental underlying causes or at least structure of our data.